see that hypocrisy in society today. Everybody wants to be politically correct and everybody wants to say what everybody else wants them to say. But this is not what a Christian should be. There should be no dissimulation, no hypocrisy, no pretentiousness. Everybody should really be honest and upfront with everything. And envy. Now, why envy? Christians should not seek to be having what others have. Just because a person has the latest smartphone doesn't mean they have to go and have the latest smartphone. That is covetousness. And there should not be envy because somebody is superior than us. There should not be envy within churches that somebody knows the Bible better than us. There should not be that kind of fundamental jealousy that is between two believers. People need to be righteous in such ways that all these kind of emotions do not come into them. And the last one is evil speakings. Now, followers of Christ should not speak evil of one another. We should not speak evil of the brethren. And we should not have this kind of wickedness in our words. Our words should be pure. And we should seek to speak and tame our tongues. And ensure that we do not speak words of vanity, words filled of wickedness, poison, hypocrisies. We should speak what we should be saying. Now let's look at verse 2. As newborn babes desires the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. You see, this is what we have been saying for 9 years. And especially since we started God's Truth Ministry 7.5 years ago, we've been saying it again and again and again. We repeat again. When we speak God's word, we talk the truth. We don't speak the language of the devil. And Christians should seek the word of God as newborn babes. Why? We are born again. So it's like babes. When a person turns to Christ for the first time, they are newborn babes. And people should speak the things of God and seek the things of God. And one of the most important things is the Bible, the word of God. If not the most important thing. Alright? Because why? Believers should always seek to know what God's plan is for us within the scriptures and to follow it. Now, we ask a question. What if someone doesn't read the Bible? What if someone simply cannot be interested of anything to do with God? Are they Christians? Highly unlikely. In fact, no. Why? Because these people don't seek the things of God. They seek the things of the world. So they speak the language of the world. That's why, how do you tell a true Christian? A true Christian sincerely seeks after the word of God. They want to know what God has to say. And that is what characterizes a true Christian. And besides, of course, having love for the brethren. Verse 3. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Okay? So you see, once Christians understand the grace of God, and they taste it, and they taste that grace, yes, you can taste it. What does it mean? When Jesus comes into you, you can feel that peace, that happiness, that joy, that contentment that comes with being a Christian. And you seek after the word of God because the word of God brings peace. In fact, one of the most important things that a Christian can do besides prayer is to read the word of God. Why? Because when the Christian reads the word of God, they gain real peace and comfort knowing that there is a just God out there. And that just God is going to lead them to righteousness and eventually to eternal life. Now let's look at verse 4. To whom coming? As unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Now, remember when the Bible mentions this before, okay, that Jesus is the living stone. It's actually mentioned in Revelation chapter 2, verse 11, 17. And we also know that this has been mentioned. The stone the builders have rejected has become the cornerstone. So we know that the stone is Jesus. Now, let's look here, and this goes back to this. Jesus is the living stone. Disallowed indeed of men. Why? Because men reject the truth. It says out there, men have preferred the darkness. But chosen of God and precious. Jesus is very precious. Very, very, very precious. And Jesus has been chosen of God as the first begotten son. So let's understand this. It is very important you see that the links in the Bible fit in perfectly. Now one last thing. For a long time I wondered why they mentioned in the book of Revelation they'll be given a white stone. Okay? Now I understand what the white stone is. The white stone is the living God. Is the Lord, is the Christ. That's why in Revelation it says a man will be given a white stone. Remember it says here, okay? Just take a look a little while, okay? What is it said? It says here, and I will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written which no man knoweth, save of he that receive of it. Now for a long time I wondered, what is that white stone? Was it literal? Now I understand. Now white always is the imputed righteousness of Christ. Symbolism of goodness. So, what stone does he have that no man knows except he that receive of it? It is, the white stone is the Lord Jesus. You have that stone, that corner in your heart, that power, knowing that you serve a living God. Isn't it amazing? It took me a long time because even after I completed so much of Revelation with you all, while I was doing this, I praise the Lord that it came up to this understanding of this, a new understanding of what the verse means. Now let's look at this. Verse 5. Ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices accepted to God by Jesus Christ. Now Christians are lively stones. That means are living stones right now on earth. It is to build up a spiritual house. Remember the new heavens and the new earth. The new temple of God. A holy priesthood. Now, there are many people who say, I'm just a Christian, I can't be a pastor, I can't be anything, so that's it. I just go to church, I'm passive, and that's it. This is not true. It is stated clearly in Revelation chapter 1, when John says, I quote, he, chapter 1 verse 6, and have made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever. Now let's put that in context. Christians are priests. Yes, we are priests of God the Most High because we are ministers of the new covenant. So Christians who think that they can sit by passively in a church listening to a pastor and they feel that they have got no responsibility and do not understand the need to be partakers of the new covenant as not just partakers but also priests to minister the new covenant are deceiving themselves about what their real role is, because Christians are supposed to act as priests of the new covenant. And what should we do? Offer up spiritual sacrifices. Now this is different from what is in Leviticus. We are not offering up rams, bulls, turtle doves, pigeons. We are not putting down goats. We are putting spiritual sacrifices. Now question, what are spiritual sacrifices? There are actually many, actually. When we give service to the Lord for His glory, that's a spiritual sacrifice. When we are prepared to sacrifice our time and our life for the Lord, that's a spiritual sacrifice. Okay? There are many things a Christian can do, but ultimately what it is the sacrifice of our lives, our time for the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and doing the will of the Father. He who does the will of the Father will be saved. That's why when Christians do the will of the Father, this is pleasing before God. It is the sacrifices that Jesus wants. As Jesus says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. So mercy is another form of spiritual sacrifice. There are many. So Christians need to see that they got to be really Christian, not just going down to a church on some Sunday and say, okay, right, on this little piece of about 2 hours, I become Christian, and then the rest of the week live like a pagan. Christians should not do that. This is highly displeasing of the Lord. Acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Now you see, it's acceptable to God the Father because why? Who's the mediator? Jesus. Jesus puts the Holy Spirit to the heart of the believer, and when we put up the sacrifices, it goes through it to the temple of God, and it comes before God the Father in heaven. Isn't it beautiful? So what are we doing? We're doing the same role as a priest. Now let's understand this. When Aaron used to go into the most holy place, or rather, when he went to offer sacrifices in the holy place, he was representing the children of Israel. Remember, he actually sacrificed goats, sin offerings, or whatever. So in that case, he was actually a kind of a representative of something, a group of people, and in this case was the Jews, the Israelites. Christians are representative of the Gentile church. We're going in with a kind of covenantal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to do what he wants us to do, because what he wants us to do is the will of the Father. Anything outside that is not Christianity. Now let's go to verse 6. Wherefore also it is contained in the scriptures. Okay, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Now this is a beautiful verse. Why? I lay in Zion. Now, we can take it as a literal meaning, but remember, we are not talking about the spiritual realm. We are not talking about Zion as literally, let's say, Jerusalem or Israel or whatever. We are talking about the spiritual realm. Now, the cornerstone of Zion, the city of God, is, there are many pillars. Of course, we know that the 12 pillars are the apostles. But also, when you build upwards, what do you have? You have the saints. You have those that laid their life for the Lord, and those that administered the covenant perfectly well. Okay? Now, it says now, Jesus is the cornerstone. It goes back to the stone. You see, so now you can see the stone, the white stone. The chief cornerstone. Why? Because Jesus is the foundation of the church. Jesus is elect. Jesus is right at the top. There is no leader in the church except Jesus. Of course, there are people who are designated pastors and so-called leaders, but that is more like an earthly governmental structure. The real leader of the church of Christ, the ecclesia, the called out ones of God, there's only one leader, and that's Jesus. He's the foundation of the church, and it's through the word of God. So the word of God has to remain as the foundation of any church. Any church that practices signs and wonders and anything else deceive themselves of having a foundation. Because the foundation is the word of God. And Jesus is precious. I would say that Jesus is completely precious to us. Without the Lord, we can do nothing. And he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Now, I got to go to this in some detail because I mentioned this one night, but not everyone was there, so I'm going to repeat it one more time. You see, when Jesus says, whoever believes on him shall not perish but shall have everlasting life, what does he mean? You see, if people just believe in Jesus, I know that Jesus exists, will they be saved? No. It's understanding what Jesus represents. For example, Jesus is the Son of God. Power and authority and dominion over the world has been handed over to him by the Father after his resurrection. Okay, and he says, and he went up to heaven. Let's understand what it means by believing in Jesus. If you understand, for example, that a teacher is got authority over you, let me use a simple example. You say a teacher comes to the class. Now, if a student says, I recognize this to be my teacher. Now, what does it mean? A teacher has authority over a class. So let's say the student does not obey the teacher, does not listen to the teacher, simply does whatever he wants to do. Does the student really can say that I believe in what this teacher is saying? No. That is superficial. He may say this is my teacher, but what does it mean? The office of the teacher is simply not recognized. Now let's understand about believing in Christ. All the pseudo-Christians think that just, I believe in Jesus, I know that Jesus is the Son of God, so I'm going to heaven. And all the verses that say, for example, there are many who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb, but few are chosen. Okay? Only who does the will of my Father shall be saved. So they ignore all these verses. And they say, I believe in God, that's all. I don't have to read the Bible. I just go to church, do my duty for 2 hours on Sunday, I'm going to heaven, ladies and gentlemen. Wrong. If a person believes in Jesus, it means they follow everything that Jesus says in the New Testament. Everything. That means they follow the commandments of God. Can I prove it? It says here in Revelation chapter 22. It says here, chapter 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. By the way, it's interesting to know. I just realized it as I was telling this to you all. What is Matthew chapter 22, verse 14? It says, for many are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb, but few are chosen. Now when we look at Revelation chapter 22, verse 14, what do we get? Only those that believe, follow the commandments of Jesus, will have the right to enter into the gates, into the city, the holy city, the spiritual heaven, forever, eternal life. Does it now make sense? So all those who claim, oh no, there's no need to have hair covering. Oh yes, we don't have to follow this. Oh yes, I'm saved because I go to church on Sunday. Oh yes, I go, you know, I go to this church because they say what I want to hear. Are they Christians? They're being biased. They are twisted. They follow their own Jesus. Now, is that authority? Is that showing that they are in submission to Christ? Absolutely not. They are disobedient. Will they enter to heaven? Yes, if they repent. If they fail not to do so before they die, they haven't. They will never step into the kingdom of God. So all those who think that, oh yeah, I believe in Jesus, so I'm going to heaven, they're lying to themselves. They're lying to themselves. Okay. Now, let's go to this next chapter, verse 7. Now, this is very important. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious, and unto them which be disobedient. The stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. You see, this, you got it. Now, this ties in with what I just said. You see, unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. Right? To those that believe, he is precious. Because they know that through believing in Christ and following his commands, they're going to be saved. And it says here, but unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. So you see, those who are disobedient, who don't want to follow, just like the Jews living in the time of Christ. Now some may turn this around and say, oh, it's only just the Jews. No. It's still applicable to the Gentile church. The vast majority of people calling themselves Christians aren't saved. It is only those that are obedient to Christ that will be saved. And you notice the word used was disobedient. So what is the difference? Remember, chapter 22, verse 14 of Revelation, it says, those who keep his commandments, that's obedience. So anyone outside there is a liar. They are not obedient. Okay? Now, how can I prove this even more? You see verse 8. And a stone of stumbling and a rock offense even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. Now think carefully this, ladies and gentlemen, whereby they were appointed. Now, is this somebody's a non-Christian or never heard the word of God? No. It says, whereunto they were appointed. Remember Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. It says, for many are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb, but only few are chosen. You see, everything links. Now do you see it clearer? That means these self-deluded individuals, totally self-deluded individuals, think they can do whatever. Now, how do we know why they're not Christian? It says here, this is such a beautiful verse. You should look at, show this to people. Even to them who stumble at the word, be disobedient. Now, do you notice one thing in common of all those zealots we've met over the years? What is the one thing that's one common denominator? Now, they may talk different bits of garbage all the time, but there's one common denominator. Do you notice that every one of them has got one common denominator? They stumble at the word of God. Every one of them stumbled at the word of God. They could not accept the Bible, the entire counsel of God. They pick and choose their doctrines, you see. They pick and choose their doctrines. So these people are cynically choosing. By the way, they're not obedient to Christ, you know. They will claim in their daring days that they're obedient to Christ. They're obedient to the Christ they created in their mind. Their fleshly desires. And that's a false Christ. You all understand? That's a false Christ. So these people are deceived by being thinking they are Christians. Okay? And remember now says, as a stone was stumbling in a rock of offense, it's offending one. Look at the zealots you're talking to, spoken to. The moment you show them the word of God, they don't want to even look. Okay? People like Sky, for example, that's a classic example. People get offended by the word of God and they call themselves Christian. They call themselves Christian. Joyce Lee is another example. So you can see all this a rock of offense. And they are disobedient, whereunto also they have appointed. Now, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. They should show forth the praise of him who have called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. It's a beautiful verse. Now, what does it mean? Ye are a chosen generation. Now, he's referring to the people that he's talking to right now, applying this epistle to those he's talking about. So, that generation, okay? A royal priesthood, remember? Kings and priests of God the Most High. A holy nation. Now, remember, all believers eventually make up the new Jerusalem, which is the holy nation. So, the holy nation is the Gentile believers. And, of course, the God-fearing Jews. And a complete holy nation. A peculiar people. Why? Because Christians are not like the world. That's why Christians are peculiar. If some zealot, like one of our former worshippers, say, oh, you know, I'm very sociable. I want to be my friends. I got to have friends. What are they? They are of the world. They are not peculiar. Now, if you feel people tell you that you are peculiar, if they say you are extreme, you know what you should do? Raise your hands and praise the Lord. Raise your hands and praise the Lord and say hallelujah. Then you are a Christian. But if you find that you have got a lot of friends and everybody feels that you are like them, put your hand in your head and be ashamed. You are like the world. Remember that. Before Christ comes back. Okay? Then I show that you should show forth the praises of him who have called you out of darkness into marvelous light. That's why. We must praise the Lord and show the dark world the light of the gospel, the light of the word of God. This is what we stand by. We stand for the truth. Okay? Now let's look at verse 10. Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Now let me explain what is this play of stuff. You see, in times past, before salvation, we were not the people of God. But now we are. And before there was no mercy, but now there is mercy. Because the moment you turn to Christ, that mercy is on to you. Okay? But of course, if a person rejects, you know, of course the mercy is not going to be on them. If they reject Christ, there's no mercy. It's just that problem. If they want to walk in darkness, they have damned themselves. But you see, the mercy of God lasts forever. If a person repents and says, look, I'm sorry, Lord. Okay, I made a mistake. Christ is loving. He will turn to his children. Christ waits for his children. And he's waiting for you to get it right. He's waiting for you to get it right. Again. 11. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul. Now, why strangers and pilgrims? Remember the passage in Hebrew. Okay, Hebrews. Okay. You see, why strangers? They were actually strangers upon the earth. Okay? As they said, it says here, of whom the world was not worthy, they wandered in deserts, and in mountains, and in dens of caves. Okay? And basically, this is what they call the strangers of God. The strangers are the very people who are unlike the world. They're unlike the world. They move around in dens and caves. They are willing to sacrifice their lives for the living God. These are the strangers of God. The strangers to the world. Because why? They are the children of God and the world cannot accept them. As Jesus said in the Gospel of John, the world couldn't accept me first and they will not accept you. Isn't it true? The world will not accept a believer. Now let's move on, okay? And what is the thing? Abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. Now, I realize this is some really truthful thing. This is a very, very truthful verse. You see, fleshly lusts war against the soul. Now, this is where it's quite scary. Because, yes, you can go over a period of time fighting this battle. But there will be a time when the Holy Spirit will be removed. It has a reason. If a person keeps struggling against it, the Holy Spirit will remain. Some people may struggle over many years, but the Lord will help them to overcome. But if they sin willingly and they're going to continue sinning willingly and take it as a privilege to sin because they think they're under grace, they're going to find out there's going to come a time when it's all over. There's going to find a time when it's all over. Okay? Now, 12. Having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. You see, now what does it mean? If Gentiles see the good works of a believer, they see a person is righteous, it will lead them to that light. And what is the day of visitation? The day of visitation means the day when the Lord opens the door to them for their salvation. That's the day of the visitation. Okay? And that will be the time when salvation comes into them. When God says, okay, I'm going to come and come to you, knock on your door, and if you open, I will come in and feast with you. That's why people we've got to make sure our conversation is righteous before the Gentiles. Okay? And even if they call us evildoers, so be it. But remember, it's also a judgment to them. Now let's look at 13. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme. Now we've got to understand here, this is not talking about the false practices of within false Christian churches. It's talking about the ordinances of man, that is the laws and the governance of the king. Now the king is of course now in the modern day the prime minister. We do not have a right to break the law. Christians may say, oh yes, my government is, a pagan government, so I can do whatever I want. There's nothing in the Bible that says that. If a law is just, for example, we shouldn't speed the road. We shouldn't spit or litter. We should follow the law. The only time that we are allowed to simply go against the law is when the law wars against our very belief. 14, or unto governors, as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, and for the praise of them that do well. Now, I believe, with the exception of people who are dictators and those who are really unrighteous, I sincerely believe that if Christians really look at it and analyze it, governments sometimes do things for the benefit. They punish evildoers, that means those that break the law. Like in Singapore, drug addicts are punished, okay? Prostitution is punished. So the government is righteous in that way. In fact, if you come to think of it, they're doing what God wants. So we cannot look at it as a negative thing. And you see, in Singapore, for example, if you do a good thing, let's say you help solve a crime, or you catch a thief, do you know you will actually be given a medal by the police and you will actually be praised? So you can see the logic of this. Christians should also uphold the law. Okay? Now let's look at him. 15. For so is the will of God that is with well doing, he may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. You see, if a Christian does the correct thing, it will silence those who talk nonsense. All those who spew out nonsense and garbage against Christians will be confounded because of the very life of Christians. Now, yes, some people, cynics will say, but Christians like Peter were actually crucified upside down on the kind of thing. But the point is this, even in their death, they silence multitudes. Yes, they did. As I will show you later about Jan Hus, when he died, they thought they silenced him. They were wrong. They started something they could never close. Okay? It started something they could never close. I'll come to that more later, okay? Now, 16. As free, and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Free of what? Free of sin. Free of bondage. Free of the law. But it shouldn't be a cloak of maliciousness to try and use some kind of agenda to hurt someone. But as servants of the Lord, okay? And by the way, it says servants, which means we serve a living God. Now, let's look at this. Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the king. Now, when they say honor all men, does it mean that we worship men? No. Honor all men means respect all men in the sense that we don't put anyone down. Love the brotherhood, which means we love one another, Christians. Fear God. To me, I place this right at the top. And honor the king. What it means, respect your leaders, okay? 18, servants, be subject to your masters with all fear. Not only to the good and gentle, but also to the forward. What does it mean? If a person's a Christian and they happen to be a servant of God, a servant of somebody, they should still serve them, whether or not they are a kind and gentle master or whether they are a cruel master. Because remember, this is also pleasing the eyes of the Lord, because it also pushes judgment onto the master for what they have done, but also as an example of the meekness of a Christian, the way Christ was meek unto death. Now let's look at this also, 8:19. For this is thankworthy, and for man, for conscience toward God, endure grief, suffering wrongfully. You see, if a man, for God's sake, suffer wrongfully, do you know in the eyes of the Lord, that man is righteous who shed his blood for the Lord? It says it also in the Bible, in the book of Revelation. It says very clearly that those who actually turn to the Lord and are prepared to do what the Lord wants, they are the righteous people who were not fearing death, but were willing to sacrifice their lives for the Lord. And that's what people, the Lord wants. Now let's take a look at this one. 20. For what glory is it if, when you have buffeted for your faults, you shall take it patiently? You see, if a person is wrong, let's say I've done something wrong against the law or whatever, and I take it patiently, what's the benefit of that? You see, it comes here, but if when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable to God. So Christians are persecuted. If you're being persecuted in your SIM, in your polytechnics and all that, and people are treating you like an outcast, do it with patience. This is pleasing to the Lord. Let them say whatever they want, because this is what the Lord wants. 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. Jesus suffered a horrible death on the cross. He was scorched. They pulled his head of his beard. Okay, they put a crown of thorns on him and they hit it onto his head. He was bleeding profusely. And they nailed our Lord to the cross. And Christ, he could have actually looked. Remember what he said? If he wanted, the Father would have sent a whole legion of angels. Everything would have been different. But he went obediently unto death as a perfect sacrifice. And that is the best example we could ever get. So there is no excuse for fear. Okay? And if you really think about it carefully, this is a very good thing for all of us. What are we fearing about? Christ has already shown us an example. Why fear a brother? Why fear a mother or a father? What can they do? At the end of the day, is it really an example when we show we are completely unwilling to stand up for our Lord? No, we are not. We are not. We're not doing it for the Lord. We're doing it for the Lord when we draw a line and say, listen, this is where I stand firm in my faith. Then we're doing it for the Lord. Okay? Jesus, 22, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, 23, who when he was reviled, reviled not again, when he suffered, he trembled not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, and that is the righteous judge, the Father, 22, who his own self bare our sins in his own body, that is Jesus, on the tree, the cross, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. When Jesus took those stripes from the Romans, he bore the iniquities of the elect. Okay? And he gave healing in his wings. Think about that. And remember what Revelation says, right? There will be no more tears. There will be no more suffering, no more illness, no nothing. Isn't that beautiful? Think about it for a word. I mean, look, this is a beautiful chapter. Honestly speaking, it's a beautiful chapter. I mean, I could read it again and again, and I won't be bored. It's some fantastic chapter. Now, let's go to 25. For ye were sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of our souls. What a beautiful end to the chapter. You see, we were like sheep. Remember the 99 sheep and the one was lost. We were walking away and we did not know what planet we were on. We were simply lost. And the shepherd brought us back Okay, like a loving shepherd. And Jesus is the bishop of our souls. He holds our souls in his hand. Unless we choose to push him away. Pushing him away is the most foolish thing a person can ever do. It's the most foolish thing a person can ever do. This is why we don't play games with our salvation. I want to share with you one thing, because this is linked to today's message and I think it's perfect. Because I found this video.